And we are live.
Ayo, what's up, video game watching people that Bill
Maher doesn't like. What's up, fam squad?
Ew, all of that was gross. Wait, when did we stream Sonic High School? Was that really 3 weeks ago?
That was a month ago.
Fuck, dude.
Yeah, it was a full month ago. Because we streamed Sonic High School. If I have it on my phone right here. We streamed Sonic High School April 3rd. And it's April, and it's May 1st. So it's 28 days ago.
28 days later, and the infection of Sonic's ball disease has spread to everyone in the UK.
I'm sorry. That will never not make me laugh. Sonic's ball disease that according to a
specified ball disease.
That according to a Chinese doctor will a Chinese fortune cookie will cause the death of millions.
And it did, so
also it turned the crocodile into stone by mere touching it.
Remember also that Sonic accidentally made that crocodile man orgasm by accidentally bumping his penis too many times during the
fight?
Yeah,
he did.
Remember that? What a fucking horrible, horrible thing that was that you made us experience. And I can't believe there's actually sequels. Are you speaking? I think I can't
not
hear
right
you
now.
Suddenly. Oh, there you are.
I'm just tweeting out the link so that you can retweet it.
Okay. Why? Because I have slightly more followers on the Twitter?
Yes.
Slightly?
Slightly. Only like two or three more, but like those are valuable followers. I can also send you the link on Discord as well.
Nah, I got the link. There you go. I retweeted it.
Would you like me to go live as well on Discord so you can see what I'm doing?
Sure.
Okay, I will do that. Okay, that is done. And we are going. So anyway, welcome, friends, Romans, countrymen, to our video game stream.
There's always the lighthouse. There's always a girl.
Who's that? Is there another person in the stream, perhaps?
Howard Speed.
Oh, boy.
Oh, shit.
How's it going,
everybody? You should have woken up so I could have put your name in the description.
I wasn't even asleep. I went outside and sat in the sun.
Oh, fuck you for going outside.
That sounds like really like concerning and depressing. Are you having like a
sitting outside in the sun? What the fuck? Why?
That's something you do when you're sad for our generation.
Going outside
is
what you do when you're sad. Wow.
I go outside and just sit alone and listen to the birds and the trees.
That's not so. That's not false. But at the same time.
Okay, thank God that you were like able to back me up on that, because I was starting to feel like a weirdo for a second that no one else does that.
So anyway, we are here. No gods or kings, only man. Andrew Ryan. We are now.
What about woman?
Of course not. Woman doesn't exist.
This
industry?
Game is sexless.
Industry? Art?
This game is sexless.
Why does David cut me off every time I want to talk, though? He kind of sucks.
All the sex
and science.
Can you fuck the Big Daddy robot?
I am positive that there is fan art on some corner of the internet about that.
Of Jack, no last name, just getting railed by a gigantic monster man in a diving suit.
Well, I didn't say it was specifically him.
Like a big old McTuck.
Somebody's getting railed by a monster in a diving suit.
Yeah, I mean, although I wasn't thinking about that, it sounds like you put a lot of thought into this. Are you some kind of pervert?
I mean, they call him Big Daddy. What do you fucking? I mean, your mind doesn't go.
I'm here to ask you. No.
Why did Andrew Ryan? Why is Andrew Ryan building androids that he calls daddies?
They're not
really
androids.
Don't like this conversation.
What the hell are they?
They're like mutated men inside of like suits. Because like the suits,
don't you play as one in the second game?
You do. Because the suits, the idea of the suits is that that's just the suits that like the workers wear when they go outside to fix like the outside of Rapture. It's like a spacesuit.
Okay. And
I love this intro though. I love this intro.
It's like Soma, but depressing for completely different reasons.
Yeah. I love the music. I love the narration.
Horrific game that I've ever played. That game.
I love the look. Everything about this is beautiful. I love this.
This is great. Look at them jellyfishes. Jellyfishing. Woo! Look, you already get to see one of them fellas in the diving suits, like, doing fixy stuff. He's like an underwater Isaac Clark.
I am so sad that the Bioshock movie never got made, because we never got to see this in, like, high-definition CGI. Can you imagine how good that would look?
Oh, yeah.
I left, you know, now I'm back, really, but nobody noticed or realized. Hello.
Hello.
You know what would be really cool is like... if they just built a whole bunch of miniatures and then put them underwater.
Bro, that would be, like, so honest. I would do a lot of things to get that realized.
Because that would be super cool, is just, like, having the camera floating underwater through actual, like, physical
space. That feels
like
something that James Cameron did for Titanic, honestly.
The neon lights would look fucking sick. I know that for sure.
Honestly. I mean...
By miniatures, I mean they would still be, like, two stories tall, but, like, you know...
Yeah.
To scale, that the structures, like, you know, would be meant to represent buildings that are, like, 50 stories tall.
Mm-hmm.
It would look... It would be huge for the sake of, like, just having a lot of depth for the camera, but it would, like, still be, you know, big enough. Oh no, what are you doing?
This dumb pop-up happened, so I just had to get rid of it. So anyway, welcome to all our viewers. Welcome to...
Oh my god, every time William tries to talk...
I'm trying to be a good host and say hi to the audience members. So
no,
I'm saying...
it's every time I talk, it's not just like... oh, this coincidentally happened. It's like, I don't know, maybe it is a coincidence, but it's just
it's
every time that I'm like saying something, David just like starts going off his own like rant and or conversation.
It is. Like, okay, it is. Whatever. Because I wait until like Xavier stops talking to say my thing.
Right, yeah.
And
no,
you're doing
I'm,
the same I'm thing.
Doing the
it's
same
almost
thing
like... we should just not have three hosts. We should have one host, and the other two can go back to bed.
That's a terrible
idea.
It's because you need some kind of... you need foil.
Are you talking about foil, like,
right,
are you talking about foil, like, aluminum foil?
Yeah, totally.
So I will answer your question in 1 second,
right? Who's the
William.
Who's going back to sleep and why is...
I just wanted to say hi to our viewers. Hi, Moritaka Ishida. Hi, Marvel DC fans. Hello, Mr. Person. Hello, Anna. Anna is in the chat. And
hi,
Iron
Anna.
Ninja. Hello, hi, Anna. Welcome.
Aluminium. Hi, Anna, don't you diss the fucking aluminium, like, way of pronunciation. Of aluminium. That sounded so
horrifically embarrassing.
Do you know if you can do...
it's aluminium and not aluminum. Aluminum is fucking stupid and it's dumbed down because Americans. Aluminium is
you're adding fucking sounds. There's not an extra I in there. Where's the E?
And you guys are taking away fucking sounds because fucking I guess
no, there's no letter to correspond to it. It's
because you Americans write it so fucking differently than we do.
You spell it differently?
Yeah, that's why we call it aluminium and not aluminum.
I just want to say that Anna's confused about what this game is, so
we're
you might want to talk about that for a second.
It's like System Shock, but underwater instead of space.
Yeah. It's that game that everybody remembers because of that one twist halfway through.
Guys, Zach is chopped liver apparently.
Oh.
Yeah. Oh, good to know that about you, man. I didn't know that. We're proud of you for.
So this is like
You know.
I don't know. So proud.
So this is like a horror sort of. It's like a action horror game. So it's got like horror elements to it, but it's not like survival horror because you don't need to. There's not like as much rationing of resources and all that.
I've never played this game, and it's not a game that really interests me.
It's like okay as a game.
Yeah.
Even when this game was first released, they talked a lot about like ludonarrative dissonance because the gameplay didn't necessarily meet up 100% with the themes and the story.
Yeah. We had to write about that about this game for one of my units for uni. I didn't write about this game. I actually didn't write that like assignment. I kind of skipped it because I haven't played the game.
Yeah.
And I wasn't about to watch like a 20 fucking hour walkthrough just to like get some sort of understanding, you know, about what the game is or why people think there's some like dissonance there. So I just kind of skipped that. But I do remember one of my assignments was to write about this game and how, you know, ludonarrative dissonance comes into play.
Yeah. And this is, I don't know exactly how that works, but this is where it came from. Because there's a lot going on here thematically, and I don't think even the story itself really delivers 100% with what the Chexa was writing.
Yeah.
But there's some great stuff in here. I've always loved this scene when he's like just freaking out and he falls over the railing.
Oh yeah, dude. I remember seeing the first part like a few months after that assignment that I talked about. It was for one of my level design assignments.
Mm-hmm.
And the lecturer was basically making us watch all these videos to sort of get an understanding of like what different developers do for like different, you know, different styles of designing levels and different like ways of like, going about things in
Hello,
a level.
Hello, Becky. Thanks
and
for joining.
How that ties into narrative. And I remember there was a scene from this game where like one of the bosses are shown, but like the game devs tried to show you what they do, who the bosses are, and like, you know, what their like ability is. And in order for like for that to work without harming the player, they had to like show it through. You were standing behind like one side of the glass.
Yeah, you're behind.
Yeah,
like,
I know what you're talking about. I've seen. I played.
And they show you what they do to like another fucking NPC.
Yeah.
Like as a means of just basically showcasing what this character is, and I thought that was really fucking clever.
Yeah.
Half-Life does that a lot. Half-Life does that a lot, and I really love it.
You know what, Dead Space does that a fair amount.
Right. It's such a common sort of technique.
Well, it also works in this type of story, because it's a horror story, so like having that sort of loss of control works within a horror story context.
Oh my god, you know what? It just reminded me of this really good example from Dead Space where there's this one enemy type that are like newborn babies that are infected with the virus and it makes them explode. Like it turns them into bombs. So if they get too close to them, they just pop you and like your like arms fly off and shit. And to explain that concept, you walk into a nursery in like a school, right? It's like a daycare area. And there's this one woman on the other side of some glass in like a classroom, like trying to crawl towards this baby that like is all fucked up and mutated, and is like trying to calm this baby that she like isn't 100% sure what's happened to it. She holds it, and then it just blasts blood and guts all over the window and just completely covers it. And then you're like,
that's
well, fuck, I'm not
going
to go near those. Yeah.
That sounds like something I've seen from this game. I don't know how or when, but like that sounds very familiar.
Yeah.
I can sort of like pick it up.
And so in Dead Space 2, as soon as you see one of those, you know to, like, kill it at a distance because those things are like grenades on legs.
And Dead Space yeah. is so fucking
I just love this aesthetic and this world and this visual design. It's so good.
Now, I'm going to ask you guys, do you know anything about the Bioshock Infinite DLC that lets you do, like, a story set here?
It's like a prequel. I know it's a prequel story, but I don't know anything else.
I don't know anything about
it. I just know that, it's after the main story of Bioshock Infinite. It takes place here. And...
In Rapture.
In Rapture, because universe hopping, and yeah, I like Bioshock Infinite. I wanted to like play that DLC, but like I could not find any like any strength or interest to get back. I just wasn't vibing because I hated the main game. The main game is like easily like one of my least favorite games I've ever played because it just was about nothing. You know? Like,
actually?
Hell yeah. Like, it just... this game writes a lot of checks it can't cash thematically. Bioshock Infinite is way worse because everything that it tries to do is half-baked because it has, you know, all this social commentary and, like, you know, this really interesting setting with, like, this group of people that is, seceded so far from the United States that they've become their own like racist society in the sky, and then that setting ends up like doing nothing. You know, it's a backdrop for mindless combat, and like none of that really ends up mattering to anything.
Oh right.
And then they have the relationship with Booker and Elizabeth, and just how those characters interact and get to know each other. And like after a while, Elizabeth just becomes like a completely different character. And just like everything that you've done with her so far just kind of ends up not mattering, you know? So like all of that is just really half-baked. And then like the universe hopping stuff is like kind of pointless because they just use it as kind of a way to just, I don't know, keep the game from getting boring, but it ends up being very distracting.
Yeah, I haven't finished the game, but I did. I got into that game, but then when the universe hopping started, I just got
well,
like,
because like the characters forget what they were doing, and the story just veers off into a completely different direction. Like the 60% like.
It just
whole
becomes
going, let's get out of the city and go to France, right? And then you get the means to do that via the portals, and then you're like, wait, let's just keep going to different universes for fun just to see what they're like, and like not making any kind of progress in the story.
That sounds boring.
And then you just hop through so many universes in that game that eventually like the story just kind of just stops. Like it just ends. There just stops being a goal halfway through, and it's just like the characters are just doing stuff for no reason.
It's kind of the thing, what even is the goal to begin with? Like, what the fuck are you doing?
Well, the goal is to get Elizabeth out of the city because she's been, like, used as a slave for their weird experiments. You gotta save her, right? And then you need to find an airship to, like, get back down to the ground, you know? And then you find one, but then get distracted, and then, like, it gets, like, hijacked. And then this group of people are like, hey, we're leading... Because it's, like, all of the underclass of the city who've been, like, you know, used for, like, slave labor and treated like garbage. They're like, hey, we're staging, like, our revolution, and we're gonna, like, take over the whole city. We need guns, so we'll give you this airship after you get us some guns. And then you go to the warehouse where the guns are supposed to be, and they're all gone. And then Elizabeth is like, wait, I can make us go to this other universe where the guns are still here. And then you go to that universe, and then instead of just being like kind of like a passive helper, you're the leader of that revolution resistance thing that happened, but you died off screen. And then it becomes like this weird thing where you just keep going to different universes where shit's like crazy. And what's weird is you end up going like 5 or 6 different ones, I feel like. Maybe I'm remembering that wrong, but you end up like ending the game not even in the universe where you started. And is it okay if I talk about spoilers? Bioshock Infinite is like 9 years old. Can I?
Well, I feel like it's a little bit off track from talking about the original game. You can finish what you're saying, and then we can move on from there.
Okay, so the big twist in Bioshock Infinite is that the bad guy who, like, runs the city and kidnapped Elizabeth is actually the player character from an alternate universe where he became a racist asshole and decided to, like, start his own city in the sky. And you're the good guy version of that character who instead became, like, a detective. And see, the evil version of him, when he built the propulsion system to, like, make the city fly, it, like, fried his nards so that he couldn't have kids. And he's like, well, I need to have, like, an heir to, like, take over the city when I die. So he goes to the universe where you, the player character, lives and kidnaps your baby daughter from you. And then you're, like, mind-controlled by these two scientists to go up to this new universe to go save her, right? But then it starts getting so far up its ass about existentialism that Elizabeth is like, hey, this evil version of you sucks, but there's also an infinite number of universes where he exists. Instead of just, like, going and living our lives in a universe where he isn't around and just being happy, I hate him so much, even though he's you, that I want to kill him across the entire multiverse. So I'm going to use my powers to kill you at a certain point in history so that you can neither become Booker or Comstock. Like, neither version of him will exist. And so the game ends with her drowning you in a river in the past. And then,
sounds so fucking stupid. What the fuck?
And also there's like six different versions of her there because so many different Elizabeths from so many different universes have such a hate revenge boner that they don't care that you're a nice guy dad version of this guy. They just hate the evil version of him so much that they want to make sure that that guy could never exist, even if it means sacrificing the nice version of you. And it's just like, you spend this whole game trying to develop this kind of father-daughter relationship with this character, only for her to murder you and kind of forget that you even are her dad. And she, like, just becomes, like, a weird emotionless zombie for, like, the last hour of the game because she has the sight beyond sight now. And she's like, oh, I can see everything. And she just starts being, like, a weird Dr. Manhattan zombie asshole.
And this is why I don't like multiverse stories as a principle. But anyway, I wanted to say... Scrubs.
The worst...
The specific section of the game that you mentioned that you saw for your lecture, this is that That's section
it.
Right here.
That's the one. That is it. Yeah.
Oh, hey!
Also, the whole thing with you walking, like, a little, like, stage thing.
Yeah.
I thought that was really clever. Because it kind of foreshadows this moment as, like, an important moment as you're getting to it. And once you get to it, like, I need to pay attention to this.
Okay, Becky's talking about what the Rapture DLC was. I didn't even know anything about that, so that's interesting. It's cool. Drill Man is fucking up this guy with his drill hand and smash him, and then you're like, oh, he could possibly do that.
This is such, like, simple and common, but very, like, what's the word? I'm tired, so I'm like,
effective.
Effective, thank you. That's a very common and simple and yet effective way to showcase a new enemy type and to show you that this enemy type is somebody you do not want to fuck with. It's basically, you just show the player what they would do to you, but like on a fucking NPC that you don't give a shit about. That is fucking genius, and that is sick, and it's always cool to see. Mm-hmm. Even though, like, pretty much every fucking game uses that technique.
You sound like you're such a nerd about game design. Why? Did you go to school for it or something?
I'm gonna go from my course. You heard right, I graduated.
You graduated!
I'm a certified game dev.
You're a certified freak 7 days a week?
Right, yeah. Wet ass computer.
Wet ass animations. Instead of WAP, it's WAH.
It's WOGged, wet ass game design.
No, that's WOGged.
Oh, yeah, true, right? Got the bleed. You can never forget the bleed. Oh, that's cool, the fucking thing electrifies you.
Yeah. You can use electricity and water to kill multiple enemies at once.
I dig that.
What else do you dig?
My mic stopped working for a second.
Oh.
I don't know what's going on with Discord. Like, my mic just keeps kind of randomly...
Yeah, it keeps doing that for, like... How long has it been doing that for? Like, a few months now, I think.
Yeah.
I don't know. Is it a hardware issue or a software issue? Because the actual microphone is fine. It doesn't do that when I'm, like, streaming or just recording voiceover. And it's... I know it's not just... anything to do with the physical microphone, because I thought it was just bumping the mic and like the connection being interrupted, but it's been sitting here on the desk and the wires have been completely untouched and it still does it. But like I said, when I'm recording scripts for videos for like 30 or 40 minutes at a time, it doesn't do it, so I don't know. I think it might be this one. Anyway, I just wanted to say congratulations on your degree. I'm very proud of you. I know you worked incredibly hard for it. And I hope it leads you to some cool places, my boy.
Yes!
Are you excited for all the Alien versus Predator stuff you gotta do this month? Oh, is it happening again?
No, we're hearing you.
Oh, okay.
We're just ignoring you.
Say anything. Okay. That reminds me. William, I gotta send you the script for that. Is he still there? I can't hear
him. He might have disappeared.
Hello?
Hello?
Am I back?
Yes, you're back. Hi, there you are. Hi.
Internet cut out. I was talking to myself like a second.
Oh, yes. Internet cut out.
Did you hear what I said?
I didn't hear what you said.
I said, just look. There you go.
Huh?
Just look at what I sent you. Look at the script I sent you.
Wait,
Well, yeah.
Oh, because Yeah.
There's part one and part two. This is part three.
I get it. No, because the first sort of like. Word of
that kind. Hey, the nice thing is we found out a way that you won't have to do any backgrounds for this, so it'll be more like the Alien stuff, but like that, it'll only be only that, basically.
Just no, like render out a transparent thing.
Yeah, just do it. Yeah, well, you send it to me. I'm editing all the live action stuff. Yeah, just do creature shots, and then we'll put it on a green screen, and then I'll do the rest.
Oh, that'll be easy. That means I don't have to, like, spend two fucking days rendering out, like, one long wide-angle shot of a fucking forest and a helicopter flying by.
Yeah, it's only character animation you gotta do.
Oh my god.
It's gonna be so quick.
I'm so fucking stoked right now.
Yeah, right? So we're waiting on Molly to storyboard this, but, Diego and I finally finished the script and did a little bit of polishing on it, too. And so, that's all ready to go. We're aiming to have the storyboards done by the 12th, and then we'll film after that, and then we'll, you know, try and get this done by, like, the end of the month.
The end of this month?
Yeah.
Oh, boy, I still got the thing with Josh happening.
I mean, you've made a lot of progress on that, though, right?
Kinda, yeah. I gotta send him something by, like, today. Oh, not like send it to him specifically, but like I gotta update our repository with some shit that I've been like working on, or like tweaks that I've been doing. I should have a few days to like do some shit, but
all right.
I don't know if like by the end of the month is like long enough. You know what I mean?
I don't know, it might be, because
I won't have to, like, do entire fucking environments.
You won't have to do any environments. It's because, well, remember, you did all the alien, like, the alien stuff in one night, you know? Just, like, moving the characters.
Yeah.
Well, you were also rigging models. You don't have to do that this time.
Yeah, maybe. Wait, why not? Or, is it because I've already done them?
Yeah, you already did it.
Oh, done. Okay, yeah.
You don't have to rig or figure out the... You don't have to rig the models, and you don't have to do the like, materials or textures anymore. It's all ready to go. You just load them in and just move them in.
I kind of want to modify the AI, the xenomorph materials and shit. I wasn't too happy with the last time, because, I mean, I kind of had to, like, just, you know, deal with whatever I had, because I was on a strict time frame. I can beat them a little bit better.
Okay, so, like, I won't be able to talk about this too much, because I'm not going to listen to the logs. But I think that I really love this section of the game with the environmental storytelling you get about, like, in the medical pavilion with, like, the crazy plastic surgeon. I just love it. It's so gross, but in that the best way.
That, like, horror movie-esque way?
Yes. Like, the demented, fucked up plastic surgeon, it's so good. I just love it.
I've seen the whole thing of Hell House. I think I know how you feel.
Yeah.
Like the TV show.
Murataka Ishida in the chat asks if I could retweet his fan comic he's working on to get more eyes on it. I appreciate the offer, but I've been burned too many times by getting a little too excited about people's fan projects and, like, promoting them and stuff, only for them to not come out. Because what ends up usually happening is everyone's got a cool idea for a fan project, but very rarely do people actually finish them. And it kind of makes me look silly whenever I promote someone's thing and it never gets finished. So my stance is, if you finish it, I will take a look at it and consider it. And that's not a guarantee that I'll promote it, because, you know, it's got to, you know. But, I just as a principle do not promote any fan projects that are, like, not done yet, because that's just led to too many disappointments, you know. So, I hope you understand.
That's a fairly nuanced position, as positions go.
Because, I mean, you know, everyone has, like, a cool idea. It's just that, like, you know, it takes a lot of work to do a comic. And I know that because I have two fan comics, like, that I've been working on. And other comics. Like, it's just getting any of that done is a lot of work. And a lot of people miss, like, they sort of underestimate that. And so they get really excited and want to, like, advertise like crazy, hey, I'm doing this thing, hey, I'm doing this thing, like, everywhere. And then they realize that they don't really have, like, the drive or even maybe the resources available to them to actually bring that all the way to fruition. And so then it just kind of fizzles out. And that's, in the 3 or 4 years I've been on Twitter, I've seen it happen, I would say at least 50 times, and the vast majority of those are actually probably Spider-Man fan projects, so I'm just kind of, like, weary about the whole thing, you know?
Spider-Man.
Hell, we did that with a Spider-Man fan project. Remember we wanted to do a cartoon?
I was about to, like, mention that. Kind of want to, like, let you finish first. I don't want to talk too much about it because I still kind of want to get that done at some point. And I don't want to, like, say everything there is to know about it because...
I don't think we could go into details about the plot or anything, but just, like...
Or even just... We'll go into a little bit of the behind-the-scenes shit. I kind of overestimated my 3D modeling abilities back in the day.
Well, yeah, because, like, you'd have to model every single character, and that's something like 100 characters.
Like, character modeling and, like, sculpting. Sculpting was never something that like I knew how to fucking do. I would do shit like box modeling, which is like super inconvenient and like not at all recommended if you want to do characters, because that's just like a stupid. You're shooting yourself in the foot essentially. Don't fucking do that. But I did that. I did that, and I'm like, it'll work. You know what's the worst that's gonna happen? The worst that happened was I spent about 3 months trying to get the head for Peter Parker modeled, and I had to restart so many fucking times. I had to restart 3 times.
Yeah.
And those 3 times, the fact that I had to restart 3 times should give you an idea of like how fucking like stupid. I don't want to say difficult, but like. It's just annoying trying to like nail the process when you didn't have the skills for that.
Yeah.
It's like 3 tries, like 3 months, just to get one character head fucking right. Not even just the body, just the head. You know. That was fucking painful and inconvenient. I would say that's like the reason as to why we had to like postpone it. Because I got it into like other, you know, shit. I had responsibilities, academic or otherwise. And I had to like keep putting it off. And, you know, we put it off long enough to the point where we're just like, it's currently in development hell until we have like actual time and skill.
And we also just need more people, man. Like, you just can't do all of it by yourself. We would need
animators. I was also back in like my, oh yeah, I can do this by myself phase, where I was just like, I don't really want to work with anybody else. I kind of want to do this by myself because I fucking can.
Well, I would hope after all the Alien and Predator stuff, you would discover that working with a bunch of people is actually really fucking fun.
I didn't even need to wait for that, man. Like, I kind of realized that shortly, you know, like a year or so after we put a sock in the project or a pin in the project.
Yeah.
But yeah, definitely teamwork. That's something that I was very hesitant about for like one reason or another. Never do that, especially on a project that big. You need all the manpower that you can find, essentially.
You need all the manpower.
A project with the scope that we want it to go for. Even a project like that's just 3D animated that has multiple characters that you need to have a lot of detail. A lot of satisfactory detail to make them look good and not just like really shitty fucking, I don't know, NPC looking motherfuckers. Like, you need people to collaborate. And that's something that I just wasn't willing to do for one reason or another. And I kind of shot myself in the foot again with that one. So, you know, there's a lot of reasons as to why the thing got canceled. But, you know, you look in hindsight, you know,
ideally, we would just, like, make a decent name for ourselves in the industry and then just get to make it as an official show in, like, 10 or 15 years or something and not have to have it be a fan project.
Because, like, that was the case, but, like,
I'm not going to go too into details, but I came up with a really cool way to adapt Spider-Man, and I had, like, whole season-long arcs written out. And you know, I had every episode's plot and like how that would fit into the arc of that season, and then like 7 seasons worth of stuff.
Also, I just wanted to say, this moment right here is a really good way of teaching the player what you can do with this power. Because you go into this room and you get like the fire plasmid, and then you have this oil that goes into the room and goes all the way around it. So then you get attacked by a bunch of your enemies when you're in this room, and it gives you this solution to the problem at the same time. I thought that was really good, clever.
Oh, that is cool.
Mm-hmm.
That's really
it shows cool. You a cool way of like using the power without also just having to be clunky. Like, oh, you're just getting fucking whacked from 2 inches away and then set the guy on fire.
It taught you a cool way to use the power without having Atlas tell you how to use the power over the speaker.
Yeah.
I like to refer to these as like invisible tutorials, where it's clearly a tutorial for how to use this like a new power or like.
Yeah, I was gonna say in-game tutorials or integrated, but that's a good way of talking about it too.
Well,
because that's like what Half-Life 2 does.
But, right? Yeah, I was about to say because I wrote a fucking essay about that actually, and I refer to those as like invisible tutorials, because what they do is they give you the scenario. And subconsciously, without like you even realizing that it's a tutorial, it kind of like teaches you how to like overcome a certain obstacle, or like how to use a certain weapon, and it does it so seamlessly with level design. It's so fucking clever because you pick that shit up without even like realizing that it's teaching it to you, if that makes sense.
Cyborg Diego asks, why do we all like Bioshock? And he says that he can't get into it for some reason. He played all three and doesn't know why he doesn't like it.
Okay.
I don't like Bioshock. I've never gotten into
it. I have a hot take. Here's my
The gameplay was bleh. And then the third one I beat, but it was like just trash. Like it was just really bad.
Okay, like, I have a hot take about this. And I will develop this at a greater length in a possible video on YouTube, which is part of the reason why I am playing this game in the first place. But my hot take for you, Cyborg Diego, is that we all fall in love with the idea of Bioshock, but not the execution of Bioshock.
Yeah.
Which is that the ideas that it presents are really interesting and thought-provoking and very, very high-concept ideas. But at the same time, those ideas aren't executed well. And that's the problem, is that there, you know, you can, you know, multiverse stories, I mean, you can do those well. Like, Into the Spider-Verse was brilliant with that type of story. Yeah. But
well, because it also knew it had like it had restraint is the thing is like just because well, you can
if
go
we're
to
going
every
into
the
specific
in
example without getting into the specific example too deep, what I'm trying to say here is that Bioshock, all of them, but for me especially the first one, has an ingenious premise and a lot of really interesting thematic beats. But at the same time, it doesn't really have... It flubs it on the execution.
Yeah.
Which is to say, we're all in love in the idea of Bioshock. We're not necessarily in love with the actual game. And that's the problem, is that we want to have this really, really great game, but we're just left with an okay game.
No, but you gotta do this. Don't you understand, David? You have to hack the pipe puzzle. You gotta do the pipes.
Well, I don't even care about the pipe puzzles. I don't mind
the
pipes.
I fucking hate them. They're really boring. They just, like, because they're so long that they just really slow down the pace of gameplay, and you have to spend so much time, like, fucking with them that you just, like, forget what you're even doing.
Again, I've never played the game, but judging how, like, you know, the puzzles in Spider-Man PS4 are, and I don't like those. I can sort
it's,
of get a...
It's,
like,
it's that, but worse, when, because they take even longer.
I mean, David's been, like, running through them fairly quickly. He's been doing pretty well.
They're fine. Like, the puzzles are fine.
Yeah, I gotta.
These stress me out. But anyway, that's my long answer to it, is that there is an interesting story buried inside a mediocre execution.
Yeah.
Bless you, good sir.
Who is blessing me?
Your mama. Ha ha! We got him. Did you hear that? Did you hear how I got him?
I heard this. I'm not gonna gratify that with a response.
Did you hear how cool it was when I got him? You have two eyes. This is a law that says we must. No,
it was fucking lame.
It was awesome. You guys think I'm cool now?
No.
Can I see it?
I have this weird love-hate relationship with Spider-Man PS4. I used to be very critical of the game up until yesterday when I'm just like, I haven't played this game in a good fucking deal. But I can go back and like revisit it. And I kid you the fuck not, I spent 3 hours doing nothing. I'm like, this is so fucking fun.
Even though you said that the swinging sucks and it's like automated.
I didn't say it sucks, I just think like, I don't know.
So what you're saying is that you have a love-hate relationship with it because you hated it until yesterday and now you love it.
No, I mean, like, I've always just wanted it to go in a different direction. That's kind of the thing. A lot of my criticisms weren't based off what the game is for itself, I feel.
It's more like...
what I went into the game...
It's not that you like dislike what's there, it's that you wanted it to be something different.
Right, yeah, that's fair. A lot of the time, it's a really stupid reason for, like, hating a game. Or, like, you know, just being overly critical of the game. And, like, I don't know, I was a little bit too, like, snobbish, I guess. But, I still wish they did things differently. Like, I wish the combat was a little bit more than just 4 combos at a time before, like, you gotta restart the whole thing.
Yeah.
I wish some like animations were a little shorter, like the fucking throw animation. You do 2 spins instead of 1 and I hate that. The fucking pull animation is like so much longer than what it was in the trailers. Or like the demos or whatever. And that really kind of irks me. Because again, it takes way too long for something to like be executed. But then you also have like my gripes with some creative shit.
You played Mild Warbles?
I haven't. I want to hit that on PS5.
PS5. Brody.
PS5 is fucking sick.
I didn't even want one.
Actually?
Yeah, like, well, I. You know what? No. You know what? That actually. That's untrue. I never wanted one. I don't think at any point was I really excited for PS5. I thought it's too early. I feel like we still have plenty to work with on the PS4. And I feel like the console is just too big and stupid looking right now. And just like too cumbersome. It looks like an annoying piece of shit to set up and move around.
It is a bit over designed.
I don't like the controller. Dude, I think the controller is so comfy looking.
I like the fucking one we have. It's fine.
It looks good, but the PS5 controller looks super comfy.
You're becoming an old man, Xavier.
Wait. I need to say that people who own a PS5 are virgins. Zach, don't you have a PS5?
Oh, that's why, you know what? That's why I don't have one. Everyone.
I don't have one.
Hannah's the reason I don't have one.
Who is Hannah?
But anyway, the other problem I have is, it's just like, every time Sony comes out with a new console, there's just a little bit more hostility towards preserving games from the previous one. And so, while I appreciate that PS5 can play PS4 games, the fact that there's nothing else on it, once again, no backwards compatibility at all, is very frustrating.
There's some, like the PS4.
Like backwards compatible titles?
Yeah, for the PS4, right? Like you can play God of War on that.
Well, because they remastered it. The only way to play any older games on PS4 is... No, the fucking God of War 3, they had to do a remastered version of it for it to function on PS4.
Oh, right, but I'm talking about God of War 4 on the PS5. Like, you can play that shit.
No, what I'm saying is that I appreciate that it's backwards compatible for PS4, but that there's 3 other consoles that they won't even touch is very upsetting, because that's like 15 years of games that are great that they're ignoring, because the industry has this bullshit mindset that, well, if it's old, it's bad. if it's old, it needs to be fixed and remade or remastered. It's like, if it shows any kind of age at all, it gets treated like it's like garbage, and it's like frustrating, you know? Half-Life is not a bad game because there's not very good lip-sync animations when the characters talk.
I'm offended that you think the lip-sync animations are bad. What the fuck?
In Half-Life 1?
Oh, okay. I thought you meant like 2.
No! Half-Life 2.
One's in Half-Life 1 are fucking next gen.
Is one of those weird games that just won't age. That game looks great.
Yeah, right?
Half-Life 2 is like fucking bullshit. Like, that game is just like, it came from the future. They pulled it from the future in 2004.
So
that game shouldn't exist looking as good as it does.
So does this mean that even though we have finished playing Half-Life games on this channel, we will never escape them?
Not until we get the third one. Also, not until we play Half-Life Alyx. So
Dude, well, I'm sorry to say, I am never going to play Half-Life. I have
VR capabilities to play any of these fucking VR games coming out. I have PSVR because, like, my dad got it for me for Christmas.
Yeah.
Like, 2 years ago. But there's, like, no games for it. So, like, I had to just kind of stop using it, like, right away.
PSVR is dead hardware at this point.
Because they won't make any new games for it. And they also, like, fucking won't make a VR thing for PS5 yet, so like I that's all in limbo. I don't have a strong enough computer to run any of that shit, and I just don't have the money for that kind of stuff.
Yeah. I mean, that's kind of the thing about like gaming as a hobby, isn't it? It gets really expensive at times.
It gets really expensive, especially if you play PC.
Oh yeah. Yeah, for sure. Okay. You gotta keep, like, updating your shit every, like, other year.
The Ironman Ninja, he says, apparently it's gonna play PS1 through 3 through emulation. You mean PS5 will?
Yeah.
Will it be able? Can I put PS1 discs in the PS5 or PS2 discs in it, and they'll work?
You know what would be really
case,
I will
fucking buy one right now.
Because I'm thinking, so much trouble. It says through emulation. I'm afraid that they might want you to buy them again for PlayStation.
No.
Well, you know, emulation means like it'll emulate the software that runs it. Because that's how Xbox One is backwards compatible. It has a digital machine of an Xbox 360's software so that it runs inside of that.
Exactly.
So.
Exactly.
See, I learn things. I pay attention.
Well, you fucking stole what I was about to say.
I just copied what you said before you said it. That's what
you like stole my keyboard, but like not actually.
So anyway, if I could seriously sit down and just like plug in my PS5 and just put a PS2 disc in it and it would run, I would buy one right now. Because then I could get rid of, like, or I could just put two consoles in storage and just have one device that does all the things that I need. Assuming I could run my capture card.
Oh, that's a cool, like, that would be... that's a cool reveal right there. Do you see that?
What happened?
So, like, frost comes over your face, and then when it clears, there's a guy right behind you.
That's cool.
Yeah. I think that there's a lot of good horror stuff in this game.
Oh, yeah.
Golden Catman is saying they already make you pay emulated PS2 games on PS4. That is not correct, because they're not emulated PS2 games, they're digital PS2 games. There's a difference. Just want to clear that up.
Yeah.
Not the same thing.
Well, they're either remasters or they're just like streaming through like PS Now or something.
Right, because San Andreas you can buy on PS4, right? Something like PlayStation.
I don't know. I know you can play the original version of Destroy All Humans 1 and 2 on there.
Well, it's kind of the same thing.
Before the remake.
Yeah, yeah. They're just like digital versions of these games.
It's a port rather than like
right, exactly.
An emulation of it. You know, it's not an old copy running on new hardware. It's just a new copy on new hardware. Yeah.
Well, no, not even remasters.
Okay, so
remasters that they released.
I love this section though. So the whole idea here is that there's I love this like crazed plastic surgeon who sort of gets tired of making ordinary like traditionally beautiful faces and just sort of decides to come up with monsters and sort of like pervert things. I love that as like a concept. I think there's not enough movies about creepy plastic surgeons.
My father was a plastic surgeon.
Was he?
And an insane. One night, he had enough of making people look pretty. So he came at me with a knife and said, let's put a scar on that face.
Let's put a big scar on that face. And then he pulls out an X-Acto blade and he's New Jack.
What's wrong with your face?
What were we talking about before? Right,
what's wrong with your face? I'm sorry,
you guys know
you
about
didn't...
New Jack? That guy's scary.
I actually don't know. But,
New Jack?
He's a wrestler from like a long while ago. He was just kind of a psychopath. Like, wrestlers would sometimes use, like, razor blades to, like, make themselves bleed a little bit to, like, add realism to, like, some of the hits they're taking.
Oh.
But, and that's fine, you know? Right? Because, like, that would heal up if they did it right. But he was like, oh, you just need to make them bleed, right? So he would just get an X-Acto blade and without telling the people he was fighting would just start sticking them with it and just start stabbing them or like cutting their faces open with an X-Acto blade, which would cut so deep that it would leave permanent scars.
Could possibly fucking kill them if like he slips
yeah.
up.
Yeah, he almost killed a guy. I think he did kill a guy in the ring once. That Jack is scary.
I think we were talking about that when we were talking about wrestling way back when.
Yeah.
I think you talked about this on a stream in the past. I think you
did.
Yeah,
I did, probably. I watched this documentary called The Dark Side of Wrestling, and they did a whole episode on him, and he showed, like, because he's still around, and he just showed up in the interviews to just talk about it, and was like, yeah, I did that. Yeah, I fucking threw that guy off this really high thing, and he broke his arm. Yeah, I stabbed that guy a couple of times. Like, he just seemed so casual about it.
Oh, Jack? Yeah, I fucking murdered that guy. That was funny.
You know, it's funny because it just so happens that the protagonist of this game is also called Jack. Coincidence?
You're old Jack.
Yeah,
coincidentally,
probably
you also stab people with X-Acto blades.
Well, yeah, but not for science, just to in self-defense.
Just for fun, for the meme, the social experiment.
You know, it's like they say, Gladys says in Portal 2, now you're playing with X-Acto knives.
She actually said that.
Yeah, she said that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
I'm not bullshitting right now. She actually said that.
No, I know. I'm just saying, like, I don't remember.
What can I do with this one?
I totally didn't think.
Oh boy, guys, guess what character got ported to Source Filmmaker?
Who?
Oh, is it Ellen Ripley from Fortnite?
No, but look. I guess that because of the demos for Resident Evil 8 are like out and like are like playable now, so people are fine. Are you having Lady Dimitrescu playing basketball?
I don't know why I expected anything. I thought like.
There's two things that model is going to be used for, is really fucking funny memes about her being tall as shit, and just the craziest porn. And I think Capcom would not have it any other way, and that's why they made that character.
Fucking hate
it.
Can you believe that they does anybody really believe that they were unaware of what they were creating when they created it?
No, because, like, in interviews, they'd be like, you know, her shoe size is like 15, and she's, like, 9 inches taller than Shaq. And it's like, you know, they wouldn't have brought up the size of her feet unless they really knew. They knew who they were talking to. The internet immediately just ran away with that. I like 15 inches?
Like, I don't know, 15 US.
No, your shoe size would not be that big. You'd have to your feet would actually have to be like longer than my head. It's 15 US. It's like it's just inches here. So like, if your feet are 10 inches long, then you're a size 10.
Well, let me get my shoe.
You all right?
I am canonically. Yeah, 15 US. Make sure you get the key. I am 15 US.
That does.
14
make sense.
33 centimeters.
Making my way downtown, walking fast.
Okay, look up. Lady Dimitrescu's, her shoe size is 17.
Oh, there you
which
go.
Which means her feet are 17 inches long. To support her. Well, your feet aren't 15 inches long. I really seriously doubt that that's real.
But listen. Okay. I don't care. It doesn't matter. But I'm just gonna say, like, I found the internet's immediate reaction to that character very amusing.
That was great.
I wouldn't expect anything less from the internet than complete unrepentant, unabashed horniness.
And what's great is just how, like, wide sweeping it was. It doesn't matter if you were gay, straight, lesbian, bi, pan, anything. Everyone was instantaneously thirsting over the tall vampire woman.
Yeah, as they should.
Like, she united all peoples in just their mutual lust for being stepped on by the giant high heels.
I don't know whether, like, I should be concerned, but I wasn't. Like, I don't know what that says about me.
Well, do you, because, like, you know about that character, right? She's 9 feet tall because she's a monster.
Yeah.
So she's kind of like a female, like, Mr. X, like a tyrant character, I guess.
Right. No, I'm over.
Oh no, crazy flashbacks.
I don't know, I just never got the whole
appeal. And this,
really,
and this, hey.
William to get, like, big into Resident Evil, because that'd be fun.
We are arriving at the first, decision. So here is this part of the game that I find the least.
Do you diddle or do you not diddle, Mr. Diddler Man?
No, it's do you or do you not murder a little girl to gain mutant psychic powers? And the only argument...
I've been asked that question many times in my life.
Yeah, it's like an important moral debate. Do you or do you not murder innocent children? It's a very thoughtful discussion, you know? Both sides have their arguments, you know? She says, don't murder children. And she's also a Nazi scientist, but whatever. Pay attention to that. He said, you will be able to make bees fly out of your fucking hands. He says,
the women. The children too, sorry for getting you off.
And your friend says you will be able to shoot bees out of your fucking hands if you murder children.
I don't want to shoot bees out of my hands. That sounds frightening.
Yo, what the fuck? How would that even, like, where would they come out from?
Your hands, obviously.
I don't even want to know the answer to that. Not even fucking.
So do I rescue or loot this small child?
I think you should do what Anakin did in Episode 3 of Star Wars.
And what is that?
fucking turtle. I slaughtered the fuck out of him.
Xavier, what should I do?
Three, when he killed all the children in the school. There's a lot of child murder.
Skywalker, what do we do? And then he's like, fucking die.
Xavier, what should I do?
I don't know. I don't give a fuck. Just, it doesn't matter. This game sucks.
Tell me what to do!
Don't murder children, probably.
Okay.
Why? No. Fucking do it.
I don't know. That's just a general thing. It's just don't murder. You know what? The great Frank Reynolds said, Do not diddle kids.
We're talking about murder. What the fuck? How did diddling get into this?
So that you could get their bee powers.
I'm so confused.
You become the bee man. By your hand would turn into the classic Godzilla Mendoza beehive.
Yeah.
Okay, but how did diddling get into the equation?
Well, just the animation of you picking them up and then like stroking their face always kind of creeping out. Yeah, you didn't see it just now?
I'm on David's
show. I know. Yeah, whether you kill them or absorb them or like which thing, you both things involve manhandling them kind of uncomfortably.
Oh my god, yeah, I see that now. Oh no. And you fucking kill them. You Anakin Skywalker.
You bite into their neck and start draining the fluids out of them.
He doesn't kill them. That's fucking cringe.
Yeah?
Yeah?
Fucking David's already. It's funny because Josh and I do that shit. We did that shit independent of each other. I didn't know he did that. He didn't know I did that. But we both fucking did it. Like that was just like us. Like separate from us knowing the other person did it. It's so fucking fun. Going yet.
Oh no, I died!
This face is funny.
Don't talk about my face like that, man.
I'm sure you have a lovely personality. I didn't know you owned us in the first place, as friends.
I'm glad I caught you.
I have to sneeze or it won't come out.
That's what she said.
Oh yeah? You wanna play like that? You wanna be that guy? You wanna do that right now?
Yeah.
Also, one thing that like is so weird about this is like so your choices are either to liberate them from a torturous existence and make them whole again, or murder them. But like, wouldn't it be more interesting if like you could rescue them from this existence, but then it might leave them with some side effects or something? No, that would be
side effects being grotesque looking in this art style.
Yeah, maybe something like that. But no, I find that's you know that's fucking stupid, and you don't know why it's stupid. Because then it might be a less cut and dry situation, you know. Maybe we would have to think about what our decision should be in more than black and white terms.
Honestly, I am completely bored with decisions in video games.
Yeah?
I'm just over it as a concept.
Didn't you talk about this in a video essay recently?
Yes, in the Batman Telltale video. But I think, like, that was, like, geared towards specifically Telltale stuff. I think in a grander scheme, I'm just completely disillusioned with choices in video games, because I think it's like what always ends up happening in my experience is that it just ends up, instead of being one really well-written, satisfying ending, it's just like two not very interesting ones.
I agree with you, but I will say that
they'll be like, well, hey, the fact that there's two makes up for neither of them being very good. It's like,
and
it's
also,
like,
also, we're really into like player choice in video games. So, if you don't provide with your audience with more than one ending, then you're going against that orthodoxy in some sense.
I disagree.
I'm very happy with the games that don't have choices. Like fucking.
There's a
really polarizing, interesting moment in the story that you have no control over, that's fine, because that's storytelling. Is like when Joel goes fucking crazy in the final act of The Last of Us and just goes completely rogue and does a bunch of horrible shit. That's awesome. And because it's like a bad ending, but like there's no like good ending where he could have stopped it. I'm happy with that. That's because that means it like stayed with me. It like I was emotionally invested in that, instead of just like looking at it and being, yeah, it has more impact because I'm not looking at it going, well, gee, what if I clicked the other button? Would he not do this? I'm not thinking about the alternative. I'm just alternative. Like, wow, this is, I'm in the moment. I'm sucked into what's happening now because I know this is the only path.
And you're not thinking like, oh, did I get the good ending or the bad ending? You're like, oh, this is the way this story has been leading to. I agree with that. But I will just say, I think that in some cases and with some stories, some video games, there is justification for there being multiple endings. Especially if you're in a game like Fallout New Vegas where your choices do actually have consequences, and those choices reflect your beliefs about these issues. And that I do think that is... when that happens in a well-executed story, I agree.
Oh, yeah. Well, no, I know that there's... I'm not saying there's never been a good example of a multiple endings thing, you know? But, like... there's never been one that's really, like, made me happy, where I was like, yeah, I'm proud of the ending I got. I'm happy with that. Because all I do is look at it and go, well, I guess I could play through it again and do the other one. And it's just it doesn't have any impact. Or you know what else I'm thinking of is, wow, if they made a sequel to this, they could probably follow up neither of these.
And also,
Well,
also, I think that with this story, I'm going to say make an argument here for Bioshock specifically, being that the themes of this story involve player choice and sort of... well, it's all about, like, self... the game is all about, like, you know, self-determination and becoming who you are, and you need... and it's good to have that... it's good to have that... if you're telling this story, I think it's effective. It's necessary to have endings. But of course, the endings they provide aren't very good. Spoiler alert.
Well, because, like, when I think about multiple choice endings, I think about, like, the fucking 30 possible outcomes to every game, and all of them are just, like, weird and laughable, and just, like, have,
or
like, the weirdest, dumbest ways that you could trigger any one of them.
Or
it's like, the ending where fucking Ethan Mars fails and his son dies, and then another character is there who's like his love interest and is like, I'm sorry both your kids died, Ethan, but let's make another one. And then he kills himself but then there's also the happy ending where he shaves his beard and his son lives, and then they just like hang out and move into a new apartment. And it's when, like, there's so many possible outcomes, I can't get attached to any single one, because I'm just like, well, this is just, like, just this half-baked kind of, like, one of 15, you know? No. Or, like... oh, yeah, because the killer was like, you have 15 seconds to shave that beard with this rusty razor, or else your son will die. And then you have to do like a QTE where you have to shake the 6-axis controller really fast to shave with a straight razor, and you cut up your face and go, Sean, while there's blood.
I really can't tell if this is a bit or like being genuine.
And then he's like, now cut off one of your fingers while I watch. And then you have to cut off your finger with the 6-axis, and you have to swing the controller down and slice off your pinky. And then you go, Sean! And then you have to cauterize it on an old stove.
Okay, but actually you have to
cauterize your beard too on an old stove.
And then actually though?
and then the FBI agent who has holograms in his brain and is addicted to cocaine shows up.
But actually?
And then you find out that you were playing as the killer the whole game and that nothing made any sense.
Wait, hold the fuck up. How much of that was it joking?
There is only one thing out of all of that was not a real thing in that game.
What was it?
It was the beard thing. Everything else was real.
What, cauterizing your beard or shaving your beard?
It's just both. Everything else I described in there was real.
Okay, the idea that you're like that reveal that you're the killer could be interesting, and I could vibe with that. So I don't know.
Well, no, not because you play as multiple characters, and one of them is the killer.
Oh.
Yeah. Well, but it cheapens it because that game does not know how to do a twist, because it's not something that you could predict. They have to actually lie to you to make it work. So when you're playing as that character earlier in the game, and you're controlling that character walking around having conversations and doing stuff, another character gets killed in a different room, and then you discover his body, right? But then at the end, they reveal that the character you're playing as just walked into the room and then smacked that guy over the head with like a typewriter or something. But like, you just didn't get to see it even though you were in the middle of gameplay, and it doesn't make a goddamn bit of sense. So like, you're seeing gameplay scenes that just didn't happen, and they don't try to explain it as like, oh, it was a hallucination. It just doesn't make it. It's just scenes that didn't happen, or just like, no, that's canon, actually. This happened. So it was like, well, what was I doing then? Because I had conversations with characters in that scene that were called back to later.
That wasn't canon. That's
not canon. Apparently, it fucking happened. Or both happened somehow. I don't know. Oh, and the other thing that's dumb about that game
is
that it's like a really shitty ripoff of Saw. Because, like, the killer kidnaps kids and then forces dads to go through a bunch of Saw-style traps to, like, prove they're a good father and that they want to save their kid. You have to crawl through a tunnel full of broken glass and then, like, a big obstacle course made of sparking wires. And then you have to drive your car against traffic. And the killer has all these, cameras and, like, machines programmed to, like, track that you're doing the things that he wants you to do. But, and then after you do them, it'll reward you by giving you, like an SD card. And as you collect them, they keep giving you more numbers, or they keep giving you more pieces of text to fill out an address where the final challenge is, right? But those cards show up in the weirdest fucking places, because like the whole thing is that your kid is somewhere in like a storm drain being drowned because it's raining so hard in this city, because heavy rain, that's the title. And there's one part in the game where one of the challenges is to go kill someone. And if you do it, you'll get a message on your phone from the killer that's like in the gun grip, and then you'll rip open the gun grip and there's an SD card in there, and it'll show you footage that's like from like earlier that day of your son who's like in the storm drain going, "Dad, help! Oh no!" But like, you've had the gun in your possession for like 3 days. So how did that get in there? They never like explain how that makes any sense.
Wasn't there like something to do with supernatural like elements?
Oh, well, okay. The big thing about Heavy Rain is that the main character who you play as and one of the other characters you play as who's the killer were meant to have some kind of like magic psychic link that would allow them to share memories back and forth. Somehow. And like that would because the main character keeps having dreams of like children drowning, and then when he wakes up, he hears.
I love
that
how
the
right? for this one. I love how this for this cutscene, I knock on the door with my wrench, even though I was nowhere near the door. So I was just knocking into air right there.
Did it work though?
What? It worked.
Nice. But anyway, so. Yeah, the main character keeps having nightmares about children drowning and then finds out the next day that, oh, the killer got another victim today. And he's like, am I blacking out and I'm the killer? He's having memories from the other guy. But what happened was they thought that was too weird and they actually decided to cut that whole story thread. So all of the weird, like, nightmare sequences that you have are just, like, cut content. But like he still talks about them in the game, so now it doesn't make any sense. It's just like all the magic stuff got written out after they wrote the whole game about magic.
Everything you're saying right now is making me really depressed because no story should be that bad. Like fucking hell.
And then also you can play as an FBI agent. Who has magic sunglasses that have like super technology future computer VR that like lets him see holograms of Mars and do all kinds of crazy video game mechanic shit. But the more he uses the sunglasses, the more it fries his brain. And so he has to start like using like hard drugs to calm down. And so there's all kinds of scenes where it's either do you want to have a hallucination of holograms in your brain or do you want to take cocaine? And then you start seeing the red room from Twin Peaks, I guess? Go get
that camera. I've never seen Twin Peaks, and when you said red room, I thought of the haunting of Hell House.
Is there any other game? Is there any other TV show that you think of at any time?
Than Haunting? No, because William has seen two TV shows in his entire life. It's Breaking Bad and Haunting of Hill House. And those are his frame of reference for all of reality.
Yeah,
if you say anything, he'll go, this is either like Haunting... Oh, this is just like Haunting of Hill... Because he walked into a house once and said... Oh my god, this has rooms
like
just like
Haunting of Hill House. It has like a door and...
But then when he was going to school, he was like, oh my god, this is just like Breaking Bad because there's a chemistry lab.
Oh my god, I'm fucking Walt Jr. right now.
I'm Walt Jr. Yeah, you are Walt Jr. Because you're a pussy.
You're a pussy.
Yeah, I keep referencing those two because I don't know anything else. It's not like the references are very situational.
If you guys haven't seen Faking Bad, which is like a parody on YouTube where someone re-edits Breaking Bad, so Walter White is trying desperately to prove to everyone that he's Heisenberg, but no one believes him and no one respects him, and his son is constantly picking on him. It's so fucking funny and awesome. Obviously, you should watch the show before you watch that, because it's really heavy on the spoilers, but it's fucking great. Like, the cops find, like, a gas mask at the meth lab scene that has written on the visor, property of Walter White, and they find him, we're like, hey, you recognize this? And he's like, no. Darling, it's me. It's Mama. I don't know if William would be able to stomach Hannibal. That show is really intense.
Oh yeah, there's some really, really intense kills in that.
The gore is pretty fucked up in Hannibal.
I'm surprised that was made for
Hannibal?
Like, can you believe that was made for network television?
Oh yeah, I was on like NBC, but like, there's like fucking people getting like cut up and then like put back together as like like museum displays, or like a guy using someone's vocal cords as a violin string. Like,
what the fuck? I saw one of these smugglers have a that's fucked yeah. up.
Oh my god, okay. So, do you know what Hannibal's about?
I don't know. I don't really know if I want to know, if I'm honest.
Oh, okay, and there's the ice pick kill in season 3. That's my favorite.
But because the kill itself is not that great, but it's the line after it that sells it, which is technically you kill.
Yeah.
Okay. Hannibal is about. It's about this this like private investigator. I guess
the TV show at least is about the relationship between the FBI he's like a consultant for the FBI. This guy called Will Graham, and he has a psychologist who's Hannibal Lecter, and this psychologist just so happens to be a serial killer and a cannibal, but he's really clever about these things, and he manages to hide that from everyone.
The serial killer. And he's so clever about it that the whole show nobody knows, but he's constantly running around like framing other people and killing people and eating them and doing all kinds of fucked up shit.
And at one point he also has this really, really like
serial killer psychology so well, he helps them catch other killers.
And he also has a really screwed up relationship with Will Graham that goes beyond, you know, patient psychologist type stuff. And
the interaction between those two characters is really fascinating, just because it's like it's kind of like this weird like toxic relationship where they hate each other but also need each other.
Yeah, it's
weird way,
very codependent, but they all the my favorite thing about it is that the show creator himself will like is very, very supportive of how a lot of the people who are fans of this show ship those two characters, even though it's kind of like a really toxic relationship. And I think he retweets fan art of, you know, them together. It's hilarious.
But, so basically it's a show about a serial killer who helps the FBI catch other serial killers so that they'll, like, get off his back, because it's easier to throw their suspicion off him if he's helpful.
And he uses that as an advantage where he makes his own kills. He foists his own kills.
Oh, yeah, no, he also is, like, you know, trying to figure out holes in their vision where he's like, okay, they're all focused on this thing right now, which means I can totally just chop this guy up and eat him.
And he, like, he will sort of do kills in the style of another killer to bring suspicion off of himself.
Yeah, that he does copycat kills. It's really cool.
Because, like, that sounds like such an interesting fucking idea, but I know
you know what? You could watch the movies, because the 80s movies are a little bit lighter on the gore, but introduce the concept. Because, you know, they're based on a series of books, and I've
read the first one. So there's two movies. There's two adaptations before the original. There is the 80s version, and then there's the late 90s, early 2000s one. And the late 90s, early 2000s one is the one that's much more famous. And it's directed by, well, it's of course the one that's starring Anthony Hopkins.
Right.
Yes. Because Anthony Hopkins, who plays Odin in the Thor movies, he played Hannibal Lecter the killer in all the 80s movies. And it was his biggest role. He was fucking amazing as that character.
And he won, like, I think he won an Oscar for it. Or he was at the very least nominated.
Yeah, and
and then in the TV show, it's Mads Mikkelsen who plays Hannibal. And my hot take...
That was, like, his big breakout role, and he's fucking awesome.
No, he was in James Bond, like, 10 years before that happened.
Yeah, but then he was...
Bond! Like,
only
that
you
is
like
his
James
big
Bond.
Break.
No one likes James Bond.
Hey, go fuck yourself. I love James Bond.
I haven't met a single person in the world who's ever even heard of James Bond. What is even what is that? Is that some kind of Mission Impossible knockoff?
What is this, like, fucking little silly cartoon show that you're talking about?
Yeah, it's a cartoon show about a secret agent who runs around being a jerk to all of his friends.
Oh, you must mean Austin Powers. I love that.
I'm just getting it so fucked up and wrong at this point. Anyway, oh, no, yeah, I actually do like James Bond as well. I'm just fucking around.
Yeah, I know.
But anyway, yeah, but I would say that Mads Mikkelsen, I feel like you were gonna say your hot take is that he's better as Hannibal than even Anthony Hopkins, and I actually agree. And that's not a knock at Anthony Hopkins. He owned that role. He was stellar. That's like one, like a,
well,
that's acting for the agent.
The thing is that
him as that
is
character.
The thing
was
is that,
legendary. But Mads Mikkelsen is just that much better, man.
Well, also there's more interesting stuff for Mads Mikkelsen as an actor to chew on, because in the part of the story that they're telling in Hannibal, they don't know yet that he's like the serial killer. So there's a lot more interesting mind games you can play with that versus in the movies where you already know he's the bad guy. So, I mean, you do know either way, but the characters don't. But the characters do as well. So there's a different dynamic there, because
It's like watching him. It's interesting watching him manipulate all the other characters.
He's not
like
putting on a performance
puppet
as a character, because he's already been exposed.
Yeah.
So there's less layers to the performance, you could say. One might say.
Huh. I don't know. Sounds pretty interesting. I don't know if I'll ever like actually get into it, because I'm a fucking pussy. But
yes.
I don't know. Sounds kind of
you can definitely watch the movie. I think the movies are just
the movies are a lot more
the level of
the, except for like one or two scenes, the movies are a lot more of a psychological thriller type thing than outright horror.
Yeah. But then the show just takes full advantage of like just the better effects. The show is like also just some of the most beautiful filmmaking I've ever seen. Like, they do some of the most interesting stuff with a camera that I've ever seen. There's a scene where someone gets shot in the head, and you know where they put the camera to show it? They put it in his brain so you can see the bullet ripping through his head in slow motion from the inside.
That's fucking... Whoa.
It's crazy.
Brain, like big IQ.
There's a POV shot from the inside of a character's skull, watching as the bullet passes through really slowly and tears open his brain matter, and then it cuts outside as his head pops. It's like, and it
actually,
there's so many ways that you could show someone getting shot in the head that are like really like blunt, but that one just like kind of made you like just really.
There's also
a
lot of.
I
remember my favorite scene, one of my favorite scenes from that show that stuck with me even to the day was the bit when Hannibal has one of his dinner parties, and then there's just this shot, which is this base, it's basically like a food porn shot where it shows you all these brilliant, like really delicious looking foods. And then you just like all these people are like, look at this guy who's made all this delicious food, and then it's just in the back of your mind that's like humans.
Well, yeah, because that's the other thing is Hannibal Lecter. Even though he's a cannibal, he doesn't just bite into people. He's like a gourmet chef, but with like people parts. So he's like cutting people up and then making like really really fancy like high quality like gourmet meals out of it, and then serving it to his friends.
Oh my god, what the fuck?
And there's like a lot of scenes where he's like cooking and it looks delicious.
And everybody's looking forward to his dinner parties all the time because they're so good.
I'm actually
but he's
raging right now. Oh my god.
It's so fucking good.
This is... I feel so uncomfortable.
I'm shocked you've never really heard of this, because it's like a really famous
I knew the show was like great. I knew the character as like, oh, he's just like fucking psychotic, like cannibal guy. He's cannibal, LMAO. Kind of rhymes.
Yeah.
Like, that's all I knew about him. I didn't know it was that fucking elaborate.
No, yeah, that's what's great about it. It's just like, it's really heady and like slow and intelligent.
I kind of don't want to watch that show like fucking ever. Like, this shit sounds uncomfortable.
You don't have to watch the show, but the movies. You don't have to watch the show, but the movies are a must.
Because in the movies, Hannibal is a supporting character.
Yeah. It's okay. Not the movies aren't about him. The show is about him because it's kind of a prequel.
It's an adaptation of an earlier book in the series, and the TV show and the movie also has a different main character. It's Jodie Foster versus...
I don't want to go too much further into spoilers, because I definitely do want him to watch the movies, because they're great.
They're decent.
We'd have to watch them together, man.
No, I would watch them with you, but fucking, yeah. It's the first movie is called The Silence of the Lambs.
The sequels you can skip.
I have heard of them.
I would say check out the movie version of Red Dragon, because it's pretty solid, but I could not get into the third movie, which was just titled Hannibal. I don't know what it was about it. It just didn't seem as, like, interesting. And
they also... The main actress...
I'd have to sit down and try it again.
...didn't come back for the subsequent films.
Wait, who's...
So, like, Jodie Foster... So they had to recast her.
Why didn't she? Is there ever like a documented reason Jodie Foster didn't want to be in the rest of them?
I know. I haven't looked it up. Bible tells me so.
Because Clarice Starling is a really interesting character, and like she really like nailed that role, but then she just doesn't come back. Don't come back down here till you've done my research.
Maybe, like, she had a falling out with the fucking producers or something.
Ah, who knows? We thought
we could hide from the light. I mean, what other reason would there be? I mean, unless she was, like, preoccupied with, like, another project. Why do we always... There was some, like, scheduling conflicts. That's kind of what happened with...
Yeah, that's another thing, scheduling conflicts.
In The Dark Knight of Batman Begins.
She didn't not want to come back, it's just she was busy.
She was filming like this fucking comedy movie that like fucking she didn't know that inside. She was like
You could have been in The Dark Knight, which is this massive like financial and critical success, and you had to
instead
be in some
this,
other
like, fucking rom-com that like everybody forgot about. Like, I don't know if you
It's kidding. Worse than oh, that. It's worse loved. Than that. I mean, she was also married to Tom Cruise at the time, so she wasn't making very good decisions overall in life.
Because that was when Tom Cruise was in his really crazy phase.
Yeah. So, instead of being The Dark Knight, Katie Holmes was in Mad Money with Diane Keaton and Queen Latifah.
Uh-huh.
I'll bet you know exactly what that is, right?
Everyone knows that. Everyone's a huge fan of Mad Men.
I don't know what the fuck the movie's about. I just know that like I was watching a video on why Katie Holmes didn't return, and they were like, "Oh yeah, she was just filming this fucking comedy and or rom com."
Well, you see, they called it a romantic comedy or a rom com because. Nobody's ever seen Mad Money, the movie.
Well, like, they specified what it was. I just forgot because I couldn't give less of a shit.
Yeah.
I just know that comedy was involved. I don't know if it was, like, just comedy or, like, romantic comedy. But, like, it's kind of unfortunate because fucking, it's the Dark Knight. Like, everybody fucking talks about that shit now. And it's been, what, fucking decades? Not decades, but a little bit more than a decade.
Did you watch the Invincible finale?
I know.
It is so fucking cool. And horrible, but cool.
What did you
think? I watched it today. I loved it because, like, they were really creative about the action in it. But also, like, it was just, like, hard to sit through because it was just, like, 30 minutes of just really uncomfortable shit. But, like, because the scene that was adapted for that episode in the comic is, like 4 or 5 pages that go really fast, you know, because there's only so much you can do with comic art and, like, you know, also have all the time for the story, but... They really slowed it down in the show so you could just, like, take a second to really drink in how bad some of the shit that was happening was. And it just made it so much more impactful, and it made it so much more, like, disgusting and, like, hard to watch. And I thought that was a really brilliant decision. Because that, it just, like, it sets the tone for the whole rest of the show. Because, like, the whole first arc of that comic, the first 12 issues are basically what season 1 was. And, like, that 12th issue is when, like, just everything really shifts into being, like, a completely different kind of story, you know?
Yeah.
So, that episode being as just, like, just grueling as it was really good for setting up just where things are going to go from here. Because, you know, you're not watching this kid-friendly, happy superhero show anymore. Like, we're just done with that. It's over. You can't go back to that.
See episode 1? What do you mean anymore?
No, I mean, episode... Well, okay. Think about it like this, though, is that episode 1, everything up until the last 5 minutes was really fun. And then it's like, it takes a break from that, and then there's a lot of, like, just fun, like, you know, little mini adventures, like, oh, you know, we'll fight Dr. Seismic, he's trying to blow up Mount Rushmore, and it's like, it's just really, like, kind of low stakes, like, kind of just, like, kiddie stuff, and then, like, now it's just like, okay, this is, oh god. But you know what's great about that comic, though, is that, like, if it were written by Garth Ennis, it would just, every issue would be like that, you know? Like the thing we just saw, and it would just be miserable and disgusting and horrible. What I really appreciate about the comic, now that I've read the whole thing, is its ability to have lighthearted, fun moments in between all of the misery so that, like, the book is not so depressing that you don't want to read it anymore. Because The Boys is almost unreadable after 10 issues. The Boys is so miserable and angry and bitter at everything that, like, I feel... it puts me in a bad mood. I feel angry at the world after picking up that book. But, like, Invincible is still able to, like, remind you that there's good in the world. The characters still, like, have fun together and are friends. And, like, there's nice, like, sweet moments and, like... So when the horrible shit comes around, you know that it means something, and you, like, care about the world it's happening in.
Because it's not over.
That was the biggest mistake in The Boys. In the Boys, every character in the entire book is an asshole. Every single person is a bad person. So when really horrible, shocking, terrible things happen, you don't care. You're just like, whatever. But in Invincible, it's like a really happy, hopeful story. And, like, the characters are really lovable and kind and sweet to each other. And, like, you know, you like all of them. And then when the dark shit comes around and, like, someone gets killed off or, like, something really drastic happens, you care. Because, like, you didn't just spend 15 issues being trained to not like anyone.
It just, you know, offsets it.
You know, I love how you asked us if we'd seen the ending of a show, and then I said no, and then you continued to discuss it anyways.
I said yes.
Well, I also didn't discuss spoilers at all.
That's true.
I didn't say what happens at all. I just told about how it made me feel. Because based on everything I said, what happens in that episode, I didn't even name any characters.
Why have you forsaken me? Yeah, what happens in that episode?
I don't care about what happens in that episode. Right, I'm just saying that it just feels a little bit weird.
You got fucking Shrek'd, bitch.
I haven't heard that in so many years. It's just so stupid and childish.
So it's perfect
like
for you.
No
two.
Better way to lose the argument than just to blurt out "get Shrek'd." Like as soon as you've like said that, it's just over. Like the conversation's done.
Thank you for explaining the joke.
You shall know who I am.
Get Shrek. Shrek.
Shrek's low, I swear. Shrek's low.
Golden Catman says, "Yo, dudes, just want to tell you thanks for more than 1 year of streams. It's really enjoyable hearing you all talk about varied subjects, especially storytelling and games, since he's trying to learn those topics."
It's been over a year now.
It's close to a year.
We started this almost a year ago. That's insane.
Yeah.
Fucking hip hip hooray for us, man. That's fucking dope.
You in the city.
We need to watch Dope again. I haven't seen that movie in like a few months.
You haven't seen that movie in 2 days.
No. Actually, a few months is like the actual thing when I'm on story. That movie's a comfort movie. I love that movie. That movie is amazing. Fucking comfort movies. I have a new one now. It's called We Are Your Friends. It's not like an excellent movie by any stretch. I like the ideas that it was trying to go for. The execution was sloppy. But it's about this DJ essentially who's like a college dropout. He's trying to escape for himself. And I enjoyed the movie. I feel like it's a very comfy movie to watch. So that might be on my list of comfy movies.
You know, it's a real comfy movie. There Will Be Blood.
Yeah, I agree, 100%.
That's so comfy.
That movie was. Yeah, that's a movie you watch when you want to get real cozy and feel good about yourself.
Dude, the ending would play.
Because I just wrote a long list of, like, good movies I know, and you watch that first, because he just picked a title at random out of the list. And then you watch that and was like, this was just 10 straight minutes with no dialogue, and that's very bold. And I was like, yeah? And he gets further into it, and he's like, this is depressing as fuck. And I was like, yeah, what'd you think of that ending? He's like, oh, I haven't gotten to the ending yet. And he gets to the ending, and he goes, God, okay. Yeah, that happened. He's just like, didn't know how to process that movie.
You know what movie I didn't know how to process? Bioshock.
The first 10 minutes of that movie was just Minecraft. The motherfucker literally goes down digging in a mine for diamonds. Finds diamonds. Fucking uses TNT to blow up even more of the mine. And, like, tell me that isn't Minecraft. Tell me that isn't fucking Minecraft. That's just Minecraft the movie right there. Take those 10 minutes and, like, turn them into 2 hours.
Hey, y'all remember when,
It's almost like the game is based on something.
Y'all remember when in... What was I gonna say? Never mind.
It's really crazy how Mojang invented the concept of mining for ore, and then we started doing it in real life afterwards.
Revolutionary company. I really want to work with someday. Dude, I love Saints.
So you could meet Notch, and you could be friends with Notch.
Oh yeah, he still works at the company. He like totally wasn't fucking.
He
like,
does.
No, he doesn't.
Okay.
Yeah, I was trying to lead into that.
You have some respect for humanity because he no longer works for them.
I mean, he kind of fucking sold the company forever ago, so he stopped working for them. Like, he never worked for them, is the thing. He never worked for Microsoft because he sold them the fucking game. And so, or the company, I guess. But, I don't know, they kind of like disowned him from the game, and they stopped acknowledging him as the creator because of some like shit he said on Twitter. I don't know exactly what he said, but
let's say they were controversial political opinions.
Okay. Well, whatever it is, I feel like.
And by controversial, I mean white nationalists.
Oh.
Yeah, it's he did a problematic is the way we say it. No?
The idea that like you could disown the creator of a game. From
remember,
like,
just, remember, remember. Remember. Who developed Minecraft? That's right, Hatsune Miku.
Notch came up with the idea.
Oh. No. Hatsune Miku did it.
Who that is?
Oh, it's she's like some Japanese like computer generated singer.
Fuck off! I thought you were for real for a second.
No, that was like it. That was like an internet meme as well.
I do now. Like, you know, he kind of fucking came up with the idea. He made the game. To be like, oh no, actually, like, let's not fucking credit them as the internet. It's fucking what shit he said. Like, there's something a little off-putting by that. It's like, I get that he said fucked up shit, and I get that. You gotta draw a line to like, fucking that. And I'm not gonna say what they did a little too far, because I don't know. Maybe it is, maybe. But there's just something a little, you know, a little scary about the fact that, like, they're.
I'm gonna cancel you for saying that.
Well, it's not just canceling you, it's literally, like, not acknowledging that you were the mind behind this product, even though you, like, 100% are. You know?
I'm trying to be sarcastic about this, and you're taking me seriously. I hope you realize how painful that is for me.
David, your sarcastic voice and your real voice sound like nothing. There's no difference.
So what you're saying is that my voice sounds like nothing? What does that even mean?
Your voice sounds like a sarcastic douchebag at all times. So I just take everything you say seriously.
So what you're telling me is that my mission is working. Yeah, I've always wanted to be taken that way in life.
Hold on, I'm just getting my Glock in.
I might get this screen banned for saying that. Things are scary right now.
Actually,
so anyway, it's a little bit after midnight. We've been going for about 2 hours.
They don't even have the guns there.
So I think I'm gonna.
Already?
Yeah, we've been going for about 2 hours, so I think I'm going to call it goods, but thank you all for coming. I've enjoyed having you all company. I appreciate every single one of you guys showing up and talking to us and having a lot of fun while we are here playing the video games.
Hell yeah.
Yeah,
that was a cool session.
Thanks for inviting me, fella.
Yes, indeed.
This so is, yeah, will, this is a nice
We
one.
Will see you this on the on the next stretch. Week, hopefully.
See you later.
Wait. We will not see. We will not be going next week because
no, next
week. Not this coming Saturday is my college graduation in whatever form that may take. So, understandably, I will be busy doing other things. So you will see us again in 2 weeks. Remember that. 2 weeks.
Fortnite.
Okay.
Okay. Goodbye.
Catch us in Fortnite to watch us
play on the flippity.